What's going on, guys? So this is part two of this video. My buddy upgrading to his brand new Jayco J-Feather 24BH. Beautiful trailer. He actually traded in this relatively new Surveyor Legend from Forest River that he just recently had. Watch the previous video if you want to see why, because I go over it in detail why he went from this unit to this unit, specifically what happened to this one. So you're going to want to watch the previous video for that. He's just pulled up. He's walking through the unit right now. We're gonna go over some details of it. Hang tight, I'll be right back. This is his brand new Ram 2500 HD with the Cummins. He told me I can open it up and take a look at the payload capacity on this truck. Not that it's gonna have any problem towing that trailer, but he has a 2,369 pound cargo capacity. Now, this would be significantly higher if he would have gotten the gas engine, but with the Cummins, this number's about 600 pounds lower than it would be versus a gas because the Cummins weighs so much more. But 2,369 pounds, you're probably gonna be transferring, I'm gonna say close to about 800 pounds when this is fully loaded to the back of this truck. So you have 800 pounds coming off of that. He's not gonna have any problem, even if he throws a generator, some bikes, and his whole family inside of this truck. Typically, I say it's about 900 to 1100 pounds total that you're gonna kill off your cargo capacity when you're fully loaded with a travel trailer this size. So he's in good shape, and this truck isn't gonna have any problem at all towing this really, really awesome Jayco travel trailer. Coming around this side, you can see that he's upgraded the tires to some Nitto Ridge Grapplers. Definitely going to get a lot more traction out of those over the factory tires he had on. They look to be a little taller as well, but it gives his truck a really nice aggressive stance. This is a gorgeous truck, and this is a tradesman edition, so this isn't a high-spec truck. He actually got probably one of the most affordably spec'd out versions of one of these new Rams that you can buy. Lots of really great technology. It's just a really nice truck in general. Looking inside, you can see he has the smaller screen there. I believe it's a 5-inch screen. Gives him his backup camera view. Does not have the center console. Has a flip-up seat right here. I'm not going to go through his whole truck. It is a four-wheel drive truck. Absolutely beautiful. And he does utilize the Anderson weight distribution hitch. I did an entire video on how that hitch works a couple times, actually, so go back, do a search for it. It's definitely something you might want to watch if you want to understand how the Anderson weight distribution no sway hitch works. Really cool. All right, so we're inside of this unit now, and the owner is standing right behind me. He chose not to be on camera, even though I can see his reflection in that window up there. Anyways, one of the questions he asked is related to the single 15,000 BTU air conditioning unit that's in this. He asked, is that going to be enough to cool this RV down in the most extreme of temperatures, if it's really, really hot outside? Because it does get really hot and humid here in South Texas. And the answer is shmaybe. It might, but it may not. And what I mean by that is if you are parked out in an open RV campsite and you don't have any type of coverage at all, no shade, and the sun's just blasting this all day, in the morning it'll probably do a fine job, but as it starts getting closer to midday and 2, 3 p.m. where really the sun starts beating down on things really, really hard, it's gonna struggle a bit. It's not gonna cool it probably as well as you would want it to, but it will probably do a reasonable job. I would surmise you're gonna be able to keep the interior of this coach around 78 degrees in that range when it's really, really hot outside, and that's with this on. Now, one of the things I mentioned in the previous video when I did a walkthrough of this unit before he was here is that you do have a really nice vent up front that is the correct dimensions to add another air conditioning unit if you wanted. You just have to keep in mind that this coach is not wired for 50 amps, it's 30 amps, which means you would have to run like a 110 cord, like an extension style cord off of the unit, or put a plug in the side that you could connect to if you wanted to run two units. And the front unit would not be ducted, so it would just blast cold air in there, which is fine because this is a relatively open floor plan and it's not necessarily something you'd have to worry about. The second thing, and this is probably the cheapest and easiest thing to do, get one of those really nice powerful floor fans, and whenever this is running, just have that thing blasting air so it circulates the air around here. You'll see that that will probably bring down the ambient temperature in here by probably 2 to 3 degrees. So having a nice powerful fan that can circulate the air throughout the coach is probably your best first step if you want to combat the heat. Your second one would be to add another air conditioning unit at the front of this. But is it absolutely needed? Probably not. I think you'd be fine with a fan. Okay, so his next question is how does the entertainment system actually provide sound? Does it come out of the TV, or is it best if he adds like a sound bar? Well, in this unit, he really doesn't need to add anything because he has two speakers here in the ceiling, one right here and one right over here, right there. And when I came out here, they actually had this cranked up pretty loud. I don't think you want to watch a Car Shield commercial right now, but you have speakers on the inside and you have speakers, I believe, on the outside that you can play your music through. Yep, right up there. So you have two ways of playing your music. You can set it up so it plays through the interior speakers, or you can switch it to your exterior speakers, and they're actually quite loud, so I don't think you would need to add a sound bar to this unit at all. Okay, we hear the TV. It's coming through the interior speakers. I'm guessing zone 2 is going to be outside and zone 1 is going to be inside, so if I want to turn off the interior speakers, they're now off. And we have the speakers outside that are currently on. If you want to turn those off, you just turn zone 2 and now all your speakers are off. Hit zone 1.
Call Car Shield and tell them the Swami said.
And your interior speakers are on. So, very easy to use, works well, and it's pretty loud too. So his next question is actually a really good question. He's an avid cyclist and he rides mountain bikes and road bikes. He wants to take them with him and he's going to be traveling somewhere where he wants them. One really cool feature that this specific trailer has is that back door that gives you the ability to load things from the exterior. And this flips up right here so you could easily anchor a bicycle right here or a couple of them. So that is really nice. It's a great way to keep them out of the rain and prevent theft in case you're going to be out and about. Okay, so now we're going to talk about the refrigerator. This is a Dometic gas electric refrigerator, which means it can run on propane or electricity, but really it operates kind of the same. This is going to be an ammonia absorbent refrigerator, which essentially uses a chemical process, a chemical reaction to cool down. Now, this refrigerator should work pretty well most of the time, but when it's really, really hot outside, you're going to find that these take quite a while to cool down. There are some things you can add that help them cool down quicker. You could add some fans at the top which circulate the air and basically get rid of the heat, which is something that you'd want to do. But you can expect a refrigerator like this when it's cold outside to cool down in probably a couple of hours. When it's warm or really hot outside, it could take upwards of 5 to 6 hours to cool down. But you want to make sure that the RV is completely level. You never want to try to cool these down when the RV is not level, because it's just not going to cool down effectively and it's not going to work the way it's supposed to. This is a pretty good option for folks who are going to be boondocking, or if you're going to be off grid and you're not going to have shore power connection. Just keep in mind some of the limitations. Once they cool down, they work really well, but the habit you have to break yourself of, and you probably already know this since you've had two travel trailers with a similar fridge, is doing this. Holding it open, looking around, figuring out what you want. With these gas electric refrigerators, the best practice is to know what you want, have a pretty good idea where it is, open the door, get it, close the door, and let it continue to cool. Holding the door open even for 10, 15 seconds can really, really hamper this refrigerator's ability to cool down properly. And that's something you're gonna wanna keep an eye on. Okay, so now we're in the bedroom area, and I absolutely love how much space they give you around the bed. That's rare in a trailer this size. Typically, they'll try to extend the kitchen area as much as possible and just give you maybe a foot of space to get around the bed. But in this case, you get a lot of room to move around the bed, which is really nice. We've opened up the bed, lifted it up. Most RVs are going to have storage underneath the bed since it would otherwise be dead space. But in the case of this specific unit, you have quite a bit. It's probably upwards of about 20 inches deep, about 24 inches long, and probably about 4 feet wide. But something to keep in mind, there's a lot of pass-through storage space up front in this unit, as well as a lot of storage space in here. And you might feel inclined to just load this up with as much stuff as you can. Keep in mind that when this is, you know, on an average loaded up, you're going to be transferring probably about 800 pounds worth of tongue weight to the back of your truck. Everything you add up here adds more weight to the back of your truck. So if you're only going to put, 200, 300 pounds worth of stuff in the front storage area, tables, you know, grill, extra things like that, then it's not going to be too bad. But if you start just loading this up with stuff, you're going to find out that the amount of weight you transfer to your truck is going to be much greater than you thought. And you could easily move from having a tongue weight of about 800, 850 pounds all the way up to 1100 to 1200 pounds if you're not careful. So managing where you place your weight is important. But also keep in mind that balancing the RV is going to be equally as important. So over here in the back, if you load bicycles back here, bicycles aren't that heavy. I mean, high-end bicycles typically weigh about 28 to 30 pounds. You put a couple of them back here, you load maybe, you know, your kids' supplies back here, any toys they might bring, clothes, other stuff like that, everything that's in the bathroom. You know, you could easily add 100, 150, 200 pounds back here, but when it comes to loading up the front, remember, the weight is gonna essentially act like a teeter-totter. It's going to offset weight that you might put in the front. So you definitely wanna be sure that you balance out the load as much as possible, and even utilize the dinette area occasionally for some things as well, since this area is going to rest primarily over the axles. Now, as I mentioned in the previous video, if you guys haven't seen that, go back and check it out. When you have a downpour and then you buy an RV, it's really a good time to buy an RV, because when you walk through your unit and do your inspection, you can see if there's been any type of water damage. Typically, the areas that you're gonna look for any type of water intrusion are gonna be around your slides. You're gonna look at this area, feel all the way down. You're gonna look towards the bottom right here to see if there's any water intrusion. Sometimes you're gonna get a little bit just because you've closed it. If the slide was open, the wipers don't completely dry the slide. They do a pretty good job, but if I pulled this slide in right now and you felt the top of it, it would feel a little bit damp simply because the rubber wipers do a pretty good job. But again, there's gonna be some residual water residue that stays on there. Also on the sides. Now, just again, checking this bottom area right here is really important. Feeling around the slides, just make sure you don't feel any excessive moisture buildup. Everything's really dry. So this is an area that you definitely want to inspect, especially after you've had a significant downpour, which I'd say last night we had a significant downpour, probably 5 inches of rain. And the outside is soaking wet, but the inside is bone dry. So that is definitely worth noting. So something else that was kind of interesting in the previous video that I saw is how the sink basin works. At first you look at this and you're kind of like, well, the water just kind of flows onto the ground. But then you pull this drawer out and you see that the sink basin is right here, but you also realize that the sink basin doesn't have a drain hole. So in terms of emptying this out, you're gonna wanna empty this out in a safe place. If you have any type of water or anything that's contaminated in a way that you can't just pour it on the ground, if you're just washing your hands, something like that, then it'd probably be fine, but you're always gonna wanna be careful how you dispose of dirty water. Okay, so one thing that's really cool about this trailer, and I didn't mention it in the previous video, is the fact that Furrion is not just prepping the back of these trailers for a wireless backup camera, but they also now prep the sides as well. So this is really cool. And when I say wireless, I don't mean wireless from a power perspective. I mean it from a signal perspective. So the signal is transmitted to the truck or to the actual display wirelessly. Now this doesn't have the cameras on, but it has the system in place. So you would simply remove this front cover and you could plug in your side view camera if you get that system. Just gonna opt for the backup camera. I actually talked to him about this and I told him I didn't find much value in the side view cameras, honestly. Now I've done reviews on them and I might do a review on the specific one from Furrion, but it wasn't an area that I felt most people would need, simply because when you put your backup camera on, it gives you a really good wide area perspective of where you're backing up. And in many cases, you don't really need the side view cameras. Plus, if you're using the side view cameras while you're driving, there could be a slight delay, and that delay could be pretty bad if you have vehicles passing you and you think a vehicle has already passed you or is coming up upon you, when in fact it hasn't yet or it's already gone by. So you just want to keep that in mind. Now on his previous trailer, he had these interesting Castle Rock tires, and I had told him I would replace these relatively quickly. I'm not a big fan of these Castle Rock light trailer tires. That being said, that's not necessarily something he has to worry about on his new trailer, because Jayco equips all their trailers with Goodyear Endurance tires. Now, are these the very best tire you could possibly have? In my opinion, probably not. They're a very good tire, not what I would consider to be the very best tire, but for a trailer this size and this weight, this is an excellent tire. And a lot of people get these tires to replace the tires that come on their trailer because they actually are a good quality tire. They don't fail nearly as often. And the fact that they're made here in America is important to a lot of folks. So Goodyear Endurance tire being already specced on Jayco trailers is a great thing. Now, one upgrade suggestion I've made to him is the fact that he should probably upgrade that equalizer. Doesn't have to do it anytime real soon. I mean, he's probably fine for several thousand miles at least on the equalizer he has. But I always recommend going to a suspension style equalizer. I'm not going to specifically recommend a brand. There are all sorts of really great ones out there. I definitely recommend going to the thicker shackle straps that are a half inch thick with the greasable wet bolt Zerks that give you the ability to really maintain and keep those parts from wearing out as quickly. So that's definitely an upgrade I would suggest making, probably here relatively soon, and we might even do a video on it. So he asked me, why specifically would you need to upgrade that on a brand new trailer? Well, the reason why is because everything you see there, aside from the tires, is steel. The springs are steel, the hanger is steel, the shackles are steel. So anytime you're going over rough road conditions, the springs are doing a reasonable job of dampening that ride, but for the most part, a lot of that vibration transfers to the chassis and into the RV itself. And that's one of those reasons why you see certain items possibly prematurely fail. By adding an upgraded suspension equalizer, it dampens. It takes like 20 to 40% of that vibration out, dampening it and preventing it from traveling into the actual superstructure of your RV. And that can really help preserve the life of your RV overall. So back at the suspension, something that's always worth noting is you want to inspect the suspension every chance you get. And what I mean by that is you want to make sure that any areas where it's welded or attached isn't breaking away. But you also want to look at the actual hangers, which are these straps right here. These are your shackle straps. And over time, they will start to elongate, stretch, and potentially break. And you want to make sure that that's something you keep an eye on. Upgrading your suspension in this area to the thicker shackle straps and the ones that are greasable definitely prolong the life of this entire area. And it's one thing that you have to worry less about whenever you're traveling, because they take significantly longer to wear out. And most of the time, they'll outlast the actual RV itself. His next question was related to the bumper. What's the weight rating of the bumper? In most cases in the past, manufacturers would say like 200, 300 pounds, but you know, they already have a spare tire hanging off of it. And as you can see, anything you put on it is going to put a twisting, torquing effect on the actual bumper itself. I generally don't recommend hanging anything off of your bumper if you can avoid it. They've already put a spare tire back here. If you're going to put like a bike rack and not utilize the space in here, you probably could. I wouldn't put any more than maybe one bike on it, simply because the bike rack itself plus the mount and the bike will probably equate to upwards of about 100 pounds. On top of that, the mount for the spare tire and the spare tire, probably another 40 pounds. So again, I usually don't recommend putting anything on the back bumper. If you're gonna do it, I would keep the weight as low as possible and use the best possible components to attach anything. Okay, so his next question was related to taking care of the roof. Now, this is gonna have a TPO, kind of a rubber membrane that's extended over the top of this unit. And you have to definitely take care of it. You have to do preventative maintenance. I would get up there probably once every 3 months with a nice little mop or something to clean it off with a hose. Nothing too abrasive or too aggressive, and just clean it off really well. Get all the debris off of it, get anything that's stuck on it off of it, mainly because you don't want anything that could dry on it and cause it to crack later. Always check all of the sealant around your skylights and your roof vents. Always check anything that could potentially lead to water intrusion. But most importantly, whenever you travel to parks, make sure that you try not to drive under any type of low foliage, trees, things that could scratch it or tear it. Because you may drive under something that you think didn't do any damage, it did do damage, and then you get a rainstorm, water and air and moisture get underneath the roof membrane and cause it to delaminate. If you take care of your RV roof, even this TPO style roof, it will probably at least last you upwards of 5 to 10 years without any problems at all. But you have to do the basic stuff to maintain it. You have to clean it off, you have to inspect it, and make sure that you try not to damage it by going under things that could potentially tear or scratch it. So his next question was, does this unit have two gray tanks, since you have two gray tank labels right there? And the answer is yes. Basically, you have a holding tank for your shower and sink, and you have a holding tank for the kitchen sink. So you are gonna have two gray tanks in this unit, and you're gonna have one black tank, which is essentially gonna be for your toilet. The next question is, what is that track above the slide for? That is if you wanna add a slide top awning. And before you ask, I would sometimes recommend it and sometimes not. If you plan on staying at RV parks with a lot of foliage, a lot of trees and things that will be above your unit, then you may want to add it, because it's definitely going to keep you from having to go up on top of your RV and sweep off the tops of your slides whenever you have acorns and things that fall on it. But at the same time, right now we have, what, 35 mile an hour winds outside. If you are parked and you have it out, sometimes the wind, if it gets extreme enough, can damage the slide top awning. So you want to be very careful when you have it deployed, which really anytime your slide is out, it's going to be deployed. But I know where you camp most of the time, and I would generally recommend that a slide top awning would be a good upgrade for you, because again, it really keeps you from having to worry about what gets on top of your slide, because when you use it, as the slide goes in, anything that's fallen on top of that awning is just going to drop off. And I think the folks here at Ron Hoover can install slide top awnings, right? So they can do that. Oh, by the way, there's Nick, my good buddy. He kind of snuck up behind me. But definitely an upgrade you might want to consider. So the interior of this coach has a solar ready sticker on it, and a lot of people want to know what that means. Well, it can mean a couple different things. On some RVs, it simply means you can put a small panel that you connect from the outside, generally near the front, to trickle charge the batteries. On the top of this coach, there's actually a plug for a full solar panel. So you could generally install like a 120, 170, 200 watt, a 300 watt solar panel on top of here, which would definitely be a really good thing for powering anything you might have in the unit off grid, aside from your air conditioning unit. It's possible to install a large enough solar system up there to power your air conditioning or microwave, but you're talking about several thousand dollars worth of equipment to do that and installation. Whereas if you install, you know, a 300 watt panel on top of this, you'd be able to power quite a few things inside of the RV, aside from your microwave, your air conditioner, or anything that produces a lot of heat without any problem at all. Okay, so up here is a good example of the trickle charge that you can put on your battery. This is basically a plug that you can get for a solar panel. Plug it in and it maintains your battery. He has a small solar panel he could actually use. It really just takes mounting it out here, setting it out here whenever he wants to charge this battery and maintain it. Because again, your smoke alarm and your carbon monoxide detector generally bypass the power disconnect option that you have, which is right here. This is gonna kill most of the power that pulls off of the batteries. But again, your fire and carbon monoxide detectors will generally still pull off of that, and it can still cause a parasitic draw on the battery. Basically, a draw on the battery that will slowly drain the battery dead. Putting a small solar panel out here could definitely help by maintaining that battery with, again, just something small that you can attach out here or just set out here whenever it's in storage. Okay, so we're here at the water heater on the side, and one of the things that he asked is, how do you maintain this? A couple ways to do it. First of all, whenever you're done with the trip, it's always recommended that you drain the system. You don't want a lot of water just sitting inside of that tank. And whenever you take it back out again, you wanna make sure that you let it fill up. This is where you're gonna drain it. Of course, you wanna make sure that the power's been off. Generally, when you return to storage is a good time to do it, because you know that over the road, it's probably cooled down. This is where you simply turn it on from out here. So you take the tape off, make sure it's on. They may have already turned it on. It looks like it's been taped over. But then you have an anode rod right here. This is essentially to help prevent corrosion from building up. This essentially will wear out over time. This is a wear component. So you're gonna wanna check this about every 6 months to a year or so. Just pull this out to see how bad it's worn away, and then order a new one if you have to. They're usually only about $10. So that's definitely not an expensive piece of equipment to replace. But this is an area that you absolutely wanna maintain and check every now and then. Of course, come out and check for things like dirt daubers or bees or things that could end up in this area and cause problems later. Something else he noticed is the fact that there's two propane connections. There's one here underneath this little griddle area, and then there's another one up here. And they're both regulated already, so you can hook a grill up to it and you can, you know, cook with a grill up here, or you can use this. But I warned him about this one. This is really cool and you can cook stuff like hot dogs, but I would be very careful if you're cooking anything that has a tremendous amount of grease, because it's just gonna splatter all over this area right here. So just one less thing to have to clean if you can avoid cooking anything on here that would just create a lot of grease splatter. You can toast your buns here, you can cook hot dogs here, sausage, stuff like that. But again, anything that's gonna create a lot of grease, a lot of splatter, I probably wouldn't recommend cooking on here. But you can really use it however you plan on using it or however you want. It really just depends on how much of a mess you wanna clean up when everything's said and done. Okay, let's go ahead and back her up and see if we can get everything positioned.
I be okay there.
I'm going to step back here a little bit so we can see how this truck sits whenever they lower all the tongue weight down. I'm going to guess it's going to drop about an inch and a half, maybe 2 inches. Oh yeah, it's going to sit nice. I like it when they put a drop leg like that.
Very convenient, isn't it?
Oh yeah. Yep, so let's go ahead and stand on the other side and see if I can get a good side profile of it. Okay, so they're gonna move this trailer, this is his old trailer, out of the way so we can see what the truck and the new travel trailer look like. But I am predicting that it's gonna be almost perfectly level without really any need for weight distribution. One of the really nice benefits of a 3/4 ton truck in this trailer. And what's really nice about this setup is the fact that, again, the truck is handling the tongue weight of this trailer really without any issue. It dropped the truck about 2 inches is what I'd say, maybe an inch and a half. But you can see right there. Looks absolutely perfect. Wow, that is about as good as you could get. Everything is sitting almost completely level. If I move here to the truck, so you can see it a little bit better, because I don't know if the camera's skewing it at all. Look at the actual running boards in the ground, completely level. That is a really, really good looking setup. So the MSRP on this unit was about $40,000. He traded a unit in, so that kind of throws all the numbers off completely, because the value they gave him for the trade-in, plus the fact that it needed a repair, as well as, you know, whatever depreciation he had there, and the sale price that they have this unit for. But I could probably imagine that the sale price on this unit was probably in the $30,000 range. Anyways, guys, if you haven't had a chance, please take a moment, subscribe to my channel. We'll give you updates on this unit as he uses it, and if we have any issues with it, if he loves it, basically anything that happens, we'll talk about. Guys, if you haven't had a chance, please take a moment, subscribe to my channel, give me a thumbs up, and we'll talk to you again very soon.